Hello, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be here and to see you all. I think this is probably my 10th consecutive, I don't know how many festivals it have been, but I have given a talk in every one, so this is an ongoing tradition. And I have a tradition of giving a phony title for each of my talks. And every year I make the same joke that I have, because they ask you for a title months in advance, and of course you have no idea what you're going to be doing. You know, they ask you in 2011 what you're going to be talking about, who knows? So I make up some preposterous title every year, and then I get to, I have this, in fact, this little thing that I do every year, which is on the morning of my talk, I open the schedule of the festival to see, because I've forgotten, to see what preposterous thing I said I would be talking about. So this morning I did that. I opened up my little thing and I said, what did I say I was going to talk? And it says, tokens, Pioneers Prize tokens, right? And that is in fact what I am going to talk about. And I don't know how that happened. How did I know? Did I plant this idea unconsciously in my brain? I mean, this is, so I was completely thrown for a loop by this fact. This is not a talk that appears in my book. And I say that in a purely self-interested way because you are not in any way, in other words, compromising the reading experience by attending this talk. So if, in other words, you thought this talk would stand in for purchasing the book, you were, that's an erroneous belief. You're gonna have to go and spend your $25 if you wanna find out what David and Goliath is all about. But it is linked in the sense that David Goliath is about asymmetrical conflicts and all of the surprising ways in which the weaker party can win and the larger, more powerful party is enfeebled. But this talk is about the opposite. I'm interested in the illicit strategies that the stronger party use to stay strong, to stay in power. And I use the word illicit because I'm not talking about legitimate means, I'm talking about ways in which they work the system that are ultimately wrong and unfair. So this talk has, there's three components. One is a very, very general idea. One is a hypothesis and one is a story. The general idea is what I'm interested in is the notion of contradiction. How do human beings not seek to avoid contradiction in their own beliefs and lives, but rather the weird ways in which people embrace contradiction? Because I believe that this is something that I've thought about quite a lot recently. I feel like we have an expectation that one of the functions of human personality is to iron out inconsistencies. And I think that's fundamentally wrong. I think actually what we do is we're constantly trying to exploit inconsistencies in our life. That's the general idea. The hypothesis is very simple, and this talk is going to be about the following. I would like to hypothesize that if Hillary Clinton wins the next presidential election, she will be the last female president we will have for a very, very long time. That's the hypothesis. And the story is about an artist. By the way, all these strands will come together. just be calm. The story is about a female artist, English female artist named Elizabeth Thompson. And I first heard about her some years ago when I read this really, really wonderful article in an art journal by a British academic called Paul Usherwood. And I should say before I go on that my arguments that are about this part of the story that's about Elizabeth Thompson comes from Paul Usherwood. And if you are interested in her as an artist, you really should go and read he's written a number of really marvelous things about her. In any case, he is the inspiration for this talk. So Elizabeth Thompson is born in 1846 in Switzerland. She comes from a very wealthy English family. Her father's family made their money in West Indian plantations, which is to say they made their money with lots and lots of slaves, off the backs of lots and lots of slaves. And at the age of 15, she starts to take art lessons. And she ends up attending what was called the Female College of Art in Kensington in London. And it's important to know that at that time in the 19th century, women were not artists. they were thought to be incapable of being artists. There was a whole line of thinking that derived from the idea that women's brains were smaller than male brains, and as a result, they were incapable of the kind of creative leaps that were necessary for fine art. So a distinction was made on the one hand between craft and design, which was thought to be within the capability of women, and fine art, which was specifically thought to be only within the capabilities of men. So the Female College of Art in Kensington was a vocational school. Women were not even allowed to paint the undraped figure. It was simply a place that you went if you wanted to know enough about art so that if you were to serve as a governess or something, you could teach children finger painting or some other activity like that. So she goes to this, but she has much grander ambitions. She comes from this slightly bohemian family. Her father is a little bit of a free spirit. She doesn't feel confined by the strictures of Victorian society. She intends to be a real artist. And more than that, she decides that not only does she intend to be a real artist, she intends to paint in the most masculine of all genres. She wants to be a military painter. Now, back in the 19th century and earlier, that was a specific field of art. These were people who took as their subject war, battles, soldiers, those kinds of things. She decides that's what she wants to do. And as it happens, that right at the time she is coming of age as an artist, there are two wars in Europe. There's the Franco-Prussian War and the Crimean War. And they become the great subjects that she will paint over the course of her career. So she starts out, and when she's very young, really in her early 20s, she does a painting called Missing, which is of two French soldiers on horseback, sort of riding through a desolate landscape. And to everyone's surprise, the painting Missing is accepted by the Royal Academy. Now, it's very important, I think, to understand what a big deal that was. In England in the 19th century and the 18th century, as was the case in France, the world of art is controlled by an institution, an academy. And in England, the academy, excuse me, the academy is made up of 40 people who are elected for life and who are very powerful, senior, socially connected artists. And they are essentially the governing body of the fine art world in England. And it's the only way you can get elected to the Royal Academy is if someone, one of those 40, dies. And the only people who can stand for election for one of those select 40 are people drawn from the group of associate members, which is itself an elite group. Right? This is really the most exclusive circle in the world of art in England. And every year, the Royal Academy puts on a show, an exhibition, in Burlington House in Piccadilly. And it's the only art show that matters in England. It is the place where reputations are made and lost. It is tens of thousands of people come through to see all the art. Because remember, in a time before any other kind of visual art, before movies and before any, the art was one of the great entertainment forms of the population. Right? So this show is incredibly prestigious. And artists from all over England will submit their canvases to the Royal Academy every year, and the very, very best are taken and are accepted for exhibition. So here's this woman, and she's an unknown, and she's in her 20s, and she paints this painting called Missing, and it gets accepted by the Royal Academy. It's incredibly exciting. Then she paints another painting the next year, and it's called Roll Call. And it's a painting, which I'm sure some of you have seen. It's of a line of soldiers after a long night campaign in the Franco-Prussian War. And they are bedraggled and defeated, and they're injured, and they're just in a state of exhaustion. They're being inspected by an officer who is riding on a horse, and he slumped down in his saddle because he too has sort of felt the burden of the battle that they have just fought. And at a time when military paintings tended to be idealized, heroic portraits, there is something about this painting that is bracingly honest. And it not only is accepted by the Academy, but it creates a sensation. So one of the ways in which the Academy would signal its enthusiasm for a painting was where they hung it in the show. So in Burlington House, there are a whole series of rooms, and the rooms are not created equal. When you walk in, there's gallery one and gallery two, and those are the choice places to have your art hung. In the back is a place called the lecture room, which is called the dark, the black hole. If you're in the lecture room, it means you barely snuck into the show. I mean, you're not one of the. The second way that the Royal Academy signals its enthusiasm is where they hang it spatially. So the Burlington House has these incredibly tall ceilings. So there's space for many, many, many paintings in rows all the way up to the ceiling. If you are in one of the top rows where you can barely be seen by somebody who is coming to see the show, that's called being skied. And that says that they didn't think your painting was that great. If you were hung on the line, however, at eye level, that's huge. That says you've really, really made it. Well, so where was Roll Call hung? It was hung on the line in Gallery 2, right? Whoa. So Elizabeth Thompson comes the day before the show opens. It's called Varnishing Day, when all the artists come to Burlington House and do the final touch-ups on the painting to make sure they're perfect. She comes to the show for Varnishing Day, walks in and realizes, oh my goodness, I'm on the line in Gallery 2. And in front of her painting, there's a whole knot of other artists. And they turn and they see her coming down the stairs, and they give her a standing ovation, right? People are just riveted by this painting. And then the show opens, and the public just makes a beeline for her painting. In fact, so many people crowd around it that for only the third time in its history, the Royal Academy has to post a guard in front of the painting just to keep them from damaging the painting and from harming each other as they jostle. And over the course of the show lasts for several weeks, this is the only thing people are talking about. In the middle of the show, Queen Victoria hears all this talk and demands the painting be removed and brought to Buckingham Palace for a few days so she can look at it. And there's all these intense negotiations about should the queen be able to take the painting, blah, 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 you know, it goes on and on. A bidding war breaks out among people who want to purchase the painting. Then the exhibition ends and the painting goes on tour all over England. And there, back then when paintings were very famous, companies would make the equivalent of baseball cards about the painting. And she sells 250,000 baseball cards with Roll Call on it. That's how popular it is. And she goes, when the painting goes to Newcastle, men with sandwich boards walk up and down the sidewalk, just say, and all it says is, Roll Call is coming. She goes to Liverpool and 20,000 people line up to see this painting at the Liverpool exhibition. She comes back and there's a banquet at the Royal Academy, and the Prince of Wales stands up and basically says, this woman is the future of English painting. I mean, she's the hottest talent we've got. I mean, it's just sort of overwhelming. She's absolutely on top of the world. And almost immediately, people started talking about whether she would one day be a candidate for election to the Royal Academy. But here we have this exclusive group of people who are the most important people in the British art world. And there's 40 of them, and they're incredibly powerful and important, and they are all, incidentally, men. But here, all of a sudden, is a woman who has stormed the ranks of this most masculine of professions. And in 1879, sure enough, there's an opening in the associate group of associates at the Royal Academy, and she is nominated. And she stands for election. And it's three ballots to get in. She wins the first ballot. And the second ballot, she's in second place, just two votes shy of the winner. And in the third ballot, she almost makes it, but she falls two votes shy. But people aren't discouraged by this. On the contrary, they are overwhelmed. This is astounding, right? This most masculine of, this bastion of male privilege has virtually been breached by this young woman who came out of nowhere. And almost immediately, people begin to talk about maybe a new era has dawned for women. Maybe women are now going to take their rightful place in the art world. And if you were an artist, or particularly a woman in England in 1879, you would have looked to Elizabeth Thompson as a harbinger of great change, right? It seemed like the world was going to change. But I say seemed for a reason, because things quickly got a lot more complicated. Now, let's take a step backward for a moment and think about the relationship between insiders and outsiders. How is it that outsiders come to be accepted by the majority? So in the beginning, the outsider is a pariah. They're not allowed in at all, right? So you have in baseball, before the color line is broken, if you're a black baseball player, you can't play in the majors. There are no exceptions to this. They flat out won't hire anyone who has the wrong skin color, right? So you're the pariah. And then what happens in baseball? Well, in 1947, the Brooklyn Dodgers accept Jackie Robinson as their first baseman. And after Jackie Robinson, the door opens for Jackie Robinson, the door opens for everybody else, right? There's a flood of black ball players who sign with major league franchises. So Jackie Robinson is a pioneer. And what you see in baseball is the transition from pariah to pioneer, right? No one gets let in, then one guy gets let in, and then the door opens for everybody else. I think we understand that narrative very well. That is the traditional narrative of progress in our society. If you look at, you can look at any number of cases where pariahs turn into pioneers. That's the story of apartheid in South Africa, right? Pariah and pioneers. That's the story of the civil rights movement in the 1960s, not just in baseball, but in numerous other areas. Blacks were on the outside, then they were let into the mainstream. It's the story of the suffragette movement. Women couldn't vote, and then one by one, in one country after the world, they were given the right to vote. They were accepted. They went from pioneers, pariahs to pioneers. But those are clearly not the only categories, right? Because there are all kinds of cases where sometimes the door opens to an outsider, but it doesn't stay open. It closes. So the first female commercial airline pilot was Helen Ritchie, who flew for Central Airlines in 1934. And at the time, people looked at Helen Ritchie and said, oh, she's a pioneer. All kinds of women are now going to be pilots. Wrong. Do you know what percentage of commercial airline pilots today are women? 7%. The door was open for Helen Ritchie, and then it was closed, right? Or the first female neurosurgeon was Sofia Ionescu in Bucharest in 1943. And people looked at Dr. Ionescu and they said, oh, neurosurgery is soon going to become open for women. They assumed she was going to be a pioneer. Was she a pioneer? No. The door closed. Do you know what percentage of neurosurgeons today are female? 7%, right? That never happened, this transformation that we all. So there are pariahs. Sometimes the pariah turns into a pioneer, but sometimes the pariah becomes a token. A token is someone who gets let in by the majority, and then the majority turns around and closes the door after them. Now, what distinguishes a pioneer from a token? And why does the door stay open for some but close behind others? It doesn't seem to make any sense. If I'm in the majority and I accept one member of a class of people, surely that would mean that I would have no objection to any member of that class. If I'm willing to accept one black ball player, why? It seems logical. I would accept all black ball players, right? If Helen Ritchie gets to fly for Central Airlines in 1934 and everything is fine, then why aren't all airlines willing to accept female pilots? But I think what's fascinating about the phenomenon of the token is that even though it seems irrational, it happens all the time. In fact, I think there are more cases of tokens than there are of pioneers. In fact, I think it tells us that discrimination is a more complex phenomenon than we normally assume. Discrimination is not about me turning my back on an entire class of people. What discrimination is a subtle and invidious combination of acceptance and rejection. Very often the discriminator may do both things in order to sustain their pattern of exclusion. So what do I mean by this? Well, I think it's important to understand that there are a series of very specific mechanisms by which tokens operate. And there are two, I think, that are worthy of talking about. One is what I would call the troubling token, and one is the idealized token. Let's start with the first, the troubling token. The person who did the most fascinating work on the troubling token is a sociologist named Rosabeth Kantor. And in the mid-1970s, she writes a very famous book based on a study of a Fortune 500 company that was in the very beginning of accepting women as salespeople. And what Kantor's focus is on the question of proportion. She's very interested in the question of, is there a difference between being the first of your kind in a group or being part of a larger minority? In other words, is there a difference between being the only congresswoman in Congress and being one of 30 congresswomen in Congress? And Kantor says, yes, there is. There's a huge difference. That the number of your kind drives the way you are treated by the majority. And she says there, in fact, is a kind of magic threshold, that if you are under 15%, roughly around 15% of the total of any group, then you're probably a token. And you're going to be treated in a very different way than if you manage to surpass that threshold. So what happens if you're one of only a very small minority? Well, she says a couple of things. The first is that you become incredibly visible. So it's a paradox. The fewer of your kind there are in the group, the more attention and scrutiny you get. You stand out. If you're the first black student at the University of Alabama, everyone knows who you are, and everyone is looking at absolutely everything you do, right? You're under a very, very bright and harsh spotlight. And that makes your life extremely difficult. Everything you do is being judged in a way it wouldn't otherwise be judged. You can't get away with anything, right? Every single step you take, the group is looking over your shoulder, making sure it's done according to their standards. But at the same time, you're never really treated for who you are. You are always a member of your group, never an individual, right? So if you're the first female pilot, you're always a female pilot. If you're the first female neurosurgeon, you're always a female neurosurgeon. People can't get past the category. So they're constantly analyzing you in terms of this much broader group that you belong to. So here you have the paradox. You are both seen and not seen, right? You are both under incredible scrutiny, but not for who you are, rather for the category you belong to. And that creates an absolutely impossible dynamic. It is very difficult to succeed, to be seen to be successful at what you do, if you're trapped in this, within this cycle, this of being seen and not seen. So she gives a bunch of great examples. One of them is, she talks about this famous study that was done of mock jury deliberations, in which a group of psychologists observe the way juries interact and reach all kinds of conclusions about gender behavior. So they watch all these juries and they say, you know what, we see all this evidence that any group situation, what men are the ones who do the kind of task-centric activities, and the women play these kind of supportive, emotional, social roles. And that study, you know, augmented this idea that there are fundamentally different strategies that men and women use in the workplace, among other things. Kantor looks at this and says, wait a minute. What the people doing that study neglected to realize is that in absolutely every one of the mock juries they were studying, men vastly outnumbered women. So how do you know what you were seeing when you observed the deliberations was a genuine gender effect? What if it was simply an effect of when people are in the minority, they both behave differently and are perceived to be behaving differently? In other words, have we confused a gender effect with a proportion effect? There's a bunch of other examples of this. There's another study that was done of officers in the Israeli army. And the question was, who's better officers, men or women? So the study looked at the performance evaluations of male and female officers. Right? So what's the answer to the question, who's better? The answer is, it depends. In units where women made up less than 10% of the officer corps, their evaluations were worse than men. In units where women made up more than 20% of the officers in a given unit, their evaluations were better than men, right? Women aren't better or worse than men. Women and men are just as good as each other, or gender is not the relevant category for deciding whether someone's a good officer. What you are seeing, though, in those performance evaluations is precisely what Kantor is talking about. which is that when you are in a very, very small minority, you get scrutinized and you're not seen for who you are. So of course you don't do as well on a performance evaluation. In other words, being one of the first through the door is really hard. It's incredibly difficult, and it's incredibly difficult for you to be judged fairly and for the majority to get an accurate sense of what it would be like if others of your kind were also let in. The great example of this, recent example of this, is what happened to Julia Gillard in Australia. Julia Gillard was the Prime Minister of Australia until earlier this year, the first female Prime Minister in Australia's history. And Australia, as you all know, is a profoundly progressive, liberal place. It's probably a lot more socially progressive than the United States, right? If you look at any number of social policies, Australia is well to the left of us. So here they have their first female Prime Minister, and what happens to her? Well, over the course of her 3.5 years in office, she was the subject of a level of vitriol that I don't think has been equaled in any other Western country in recent memory. It's kind of unbelievable to read about what happened to her. The Julia Baird, who's an Australian writer who's written a lot about this, here's how she describes what happened to Julia Gillard. For the 3 years and 3 days that Julia Gillard was Prime Minister of Australia, we debated the fit of her jackets, the size of her bottom, the exposure of her cleavage, the cut of her hair, the tone of her voice, the legitimacy of her rule, and whether she had chosen, as one member of parliament from the opposition Liberal Party put it, to be deliberately barren. Her opponents would routinely circulate these lewd, disgusting sexual cartoons that involved the Prime Minister of their own country. The big rallying cry of her critics was ditch the witch. People would march up and down with placards that said ditch the witch. The newspapers would refer to her as Julia, as if she was a reality star and not the head of state. The CEO of a major Australian company said on the record, called her an unproductive old cow. One restaurant offered on its menu the Julia Gillard Kentucky Fried Quail. Small breasts, huge thighs, and a big red box. At the end of her term, she gave a speech in which she just talked in a very frank and moving way about the sexism she'd encountered in her time in office. And immediately after she gives that speech, she is accused of igniting gender wars, right? As if she started it. Right at the very end of her time in office, her father dies, and one of the prominent radio, the Rush Limbaugh of Australia, says that he must have died of shame. And then on the floor of parliament, the leader of the opposition repeats the phrase and says, and now it's time for her government to die of shame. I don't need to point out what's obvious here, which is if she had been a man, she would not have been treated this way, right? This is about there's something about her that invites a very different kind of response than a man would have gotten in that situation. She could not be considered simply as Julia Gillard, politician, even though she was a highly capable, tough-minded, funny, smart politician who guided Australia through one of the most difficult 3-year periods in recent history. No one could think about her just as a politician. They had to think about her as Julia Gillard, female politician. She couldn't transcend her category. And that's exactly what Rosabeth Kanter is talking about. That's the great dilemma of the token. You know, at her last prime minister, last news conference as prime minister, after she has endured months and months of this extraordinary abuse, she says, you know, what I am absolutely confident of is that it will be easier for the next woman and for the woman after that and the woman after that, and I'm proud of that. You can understand why she says that. She's looking for a silver lining. She wants to believe that she is a pioneer, right? And that she took all of these blows for the general cause of women. And that as a result of her being a kind of sacrificial lamb, the door will open for others. But I think it's just as easy to make the opposite case. That what the Gillard experience taught Australians is they didn't want another woman, right? They so convinced themselves that she was such a terrible person that now they will feel justified in turning their back on the entire category and saying, look, we tried a woman. Look what happened. We're not going to do that again, right? So that's the troubling token, the token who convinces you that you made a mistake when you opened the door. There's a second category, though, which I think is even more important and consequential, and that's what I would call the idealized token. Because it's not always the case that the token is vilified. It is also sometimes the case that the token is praised and glorified. And that turns out to be every bit as problematic for everyone else as when the token is vilified. I don't know how many of you have read Amos Salon's book, The Pity of It All, which is a really wonderful book. It's about the experience of Jews in Germany over the course of German history. And what he's interested in is the great paradox of the role Jews play in Germany, which is that here's a country with obviously this horrifying history of anti-Semitism. And yet, over the course of its history, Jews have played a central role in the cultural and intellectual and commercial life of Germany and the German states, right, for part of unification. In other words, German anti-Semitism exists not in a climate of rejection of all things Jewish, but it exists rather in a climate of a rejection of some things Jewish. They always had some Jews close to their heart, even as they turned their back on others. So, for example, from the 17th century onwards, German states, alone among Western European states, had court Jews. They had strict policies that said if you were Jewish, you couldn't live within our city gates, except for some Jews. We can let some in. Some Jews who we think are educated and can play important roles in the business community and who can lend us money or do whatever things. We'll let some in. In fact, in 1730, the King of Prussia launches this anti-Semitic campaign in which he says that Jews have become a plague of locusts on the Prussian people. Right? And you think he's going to kick out all the Jews from Berlin. No. He kicks out 140 families and he hangs on to 120, right? The same pattern, you see the same pattern over and over again in Germany in this period. Moses Mendelssohn is in the 18th century considered to be one of the most brilliant men in the country. And he's Jewish, of course. And by rights, he's not fancy Jewish. By rights, he shouldn't be allowed to live in Berlin. So what do? Well, they want him around. So they create exceptional status for him. It's like an H-1 visa. And they basically say, you're going to be our un-Jewish Jew. We're going to carve out a little exception for you so we can have you around. The same thing happens with the writer Bertolt Auerbach, who in the mid-19th century, is the most popular German novelist. And he writes these tales about Jews and Catholics living in harmony in small villages in the Black Forest in Germany. And the man is beloved. I mean, he is the most popular German novelist. Turgenev compares him to Dickens. He's a huge deal. And over the course of his career, he is spared from all the anti-Semitism around him. No one ever turns on Bertolt Auerbach, even as they are turning on every other Jew they can find. Richard Wagner, the notorious anti-Semite, loves Bertolt Auerbach. Goes on about how Bertolt Auerbach has glimpsed into the soul of the German people, right? The Grimm brothers love Bertolt Auerbach, right? I don't know whether they're anti-Semites, but probably, right? The Germans hate Jews, but they love Auerbach. So what's going on here? It's a contradiction, right? How can you love someone who is Jewish and simultaneously turn your backs on other people who are Jewish? Well, I think what's going on here is a version of what the psychologist Binet Monin has called moral license. And he's done all of this really interesting work where he proposes that as human beings, when we make sense of our behavior, we do a kind of complex accounting, we use pro-social or moral choices as ways of justifying antisocial immoral choices, right? It's like carbon offsets. Because we do a good thing over here, we feel justified for doing a bad thing over here. Now, that's an interesting notion because for the longest time in psychology, we have thought that people very rigorously police their behavior in order to enforce some kind of consistency. That if when we said that you are moral, what we meant is that you are someone who tends to behave in a moral way in all aspects of your life. What Mona is saying is no, that's not how we behave. As human beings, what we do is we do the good thing over here, and then we use that to justify doing the bad thing over here. Right? In other words, the Germans did not hate Jews in spite of the fact that they loved Berthold Auerbach. They hated Jews because of the fact they loved Berthold Auerbach. Opening the door to Berthold Auerbach is what allowed them to justify closing the door to everybody else. You know, if you read any account of the life of Adolf Eichmann, one of the architects of the Final Solution, you will be struck by precisely this phenomenon. It's kind of fascinating. You know, during the 1930s, before Nazi Germany had embarked on a policy of extermination of Jews, they had as their policy that Jews should be deported. And the head of the deportation policy in Vienna was Adolf Eichmann. And Adolf Eichmann was an exceedingly capable bureaucrat, as he would prove to devastating effect later in the war. And over the course of, in the 1930s, when he was posted in Vienna, he was responsible for the deportation of 128,000 Jews. And like I said, he's really good at it. He creates this streamlined bureaucratic process for getting Jews out of Austria. And he figures out a way to essentially steal money from rich Jews to pay for the deportation of poor Jews. And he has this one-stop, you know, you go to one office and they do it all in one day, like right then and there. In fact, there's a memoir by the guy who founded, one of the founders of the Mossad, a guy named Ehud Avriel, and talks about, he was a Viennese Jew. He talks about going to Eichmann's office in the 1930s because he's trying to get out of Austria. And he has 100 people that he wants to take with him. And he's like, he talks about being treated like a preferred customer. 100! Eichmann like ushers him in and like offers him tea and then and devises some streamlined way where they could just issue, instead of issuing 100 passports for every one of them, he gives them just one passport for all 100. It's like, that way we can do this faster. And during this time that Eichmann is doing this deportation, he tries to teach himself Hebrew. And he visits Jerusalem. And he reads Theodor Herzl's famous book on Zionism. And Hannah Arendt in Eichmann Jerusalem has this line about how it's the only serious book he ever read. But it has an incredible effect on him. And he starts to call himself a Zionist because he says, look, Zionism is about going back to the Holy Land. I am sending people back to the Holy Land, right? In this weird, perverted way, he convinces himself he's on the side of the Zionists. And when Herzl's grave is desecrated, Eichmann speaks up, says, you can't desecrate a grave of. And when there's a ceremony for the 35th anniversary of Herzl's death, Eichmann's in the crowd, right? Come to honor one of his heroes. You know, there's a, in every account of Eichmann's life, there's always a moment where the historian tries to make sense of this contradiction. How can someone who was running around in the 1930s calling himself a Zionist possibly turn into the monster who puts together the Final Solution in the 1940s, right? And they always have to come up with some complex narrative of transformation. Well, I don't think the contradiction needs to be resolved at all. I think the contradiction is the point, right? You know, the camp that Eichmann sets up is, and I'm mispronouncing it, Theresienstadt. That's his own pet concentration camp. And it's a horrible place. 33,000 people die there, and 88,000 people are shipped to Auschwitz from Theresienstadt. And he goes and would visit it all the time because it's the one he was personally responsible for. And he has, at the camp, a library. And he has gone, he went to Prague, and he basically looted a Jewish library in Prague, brought all of the volumes to Theresienstadt. And when he would visit Theresienstadt, he would go into the library and read Judaica as people outside were being sent off to Auschwitz, right? When he's on trial in Jerusalem in the 1960s, he would always talk about how uncomfortable he was with the Final Solution, that he wasn't one of those Nazis who just flat out hated Jews. And people didn't know what to make of this. It's so preposterous, right, that he could say this. But you understand in his sick, perverted way what he's getting at. He can always say, look, I'm the guy. How can I be a monster? I'm the guy who tried to get Jews out of Europe in the 1930s. I can't be a butcher. I'm a Zionist. That's how he justifies his behavior in the 1940s. There's this one line, he's talking to one of his interrogators, and he said, I had no hatred for Jews. First of all, Eichmann is saying this. I had no hatred for Jews. Even in elementary school, I had a Jewish classmate with whom I spent my free time. And he came to our house, a family in Linz by the name of Seba. The last time we met, we walked together through the streets of Linz, I already with my Nazi party emblem, and he did not think anything of it. Some of my best friends are Jews. That's what he's saying, right? It's exactly what he's saying. And in that, in his sort of sick, perverted way, what he is explaining is how that contradiction made his behavior during the Final Solution possible. Because he opened the door for Jews in the 1930s, he could live with himself when he slammed it shut in the 1940s. Right? That's a really outlandish, outlying example, but I think it expresses something that is fundamental to the way we behave as human beings. We do not run from the contradictions in our life. On the contrary, we exploit them. We use contradictions as a way to justify our behavior. So back to Elizabeth Thompson. When Thompson submits roll call to the Academy is in turmoil. They're under a lot of fire. Here we have this group of 40 old white men who are basically controlling the art world in England, and all of the painters and sculptors who are underneath are growing very restless. They have become convinced that this small group of men do not represent their interests. And there's a kind of a revolt brewing. And the strong consensus is these guys are out of touch. They're, for example, Burlington House, where all the artists hung, was too small. And what that meant was that many of the paintings that were accepted by the Academy every year for exhibition couldn't be, there was no place to hang them. So they would just languish in a warehouse. And the attitude of the artists was, this is outrageous. And no one in the Academy seemed to care. More than that, the Academy had rules which said that if you were a member of the Academy, you could essentially exhibit as many pieces of art as you wanted to. You could, up to 8 paintings you could hang just for yourself. So the Academy members are allowing themselves, each other, to hang as many as they want, and everyone else is being left out in the cold. So anyway, there is this revolt brewing, and they're aware of this. And so they're looking for a way to appear, to demonstrate to the world that they are more liberal and more open and tolerant, right? So what happens? Well, along comes this brilliant female painter who has painted this astonishing work called Roll Call. So what do? They hang it on the line in Gallery 2, and they proclaim to the world, no, this is who we are, right? We're the guys who'll hang Roll Call on the line in Gallery 2. And sure enough, if you read the art press right around the time that happens, everyone is so overwhelmed with the symbolism of this. This is a sign that the world of art is in England is open to anyone of genius, right? It's a meritocracy. Look how they treated someone who you wouldn't have thought would have made it at all into the Royal Academy. And it's 2 years after that that Thompson runs for she runs for election to the Academy, and she's one of the most famous artists in all of England at that point. And she is the first woman ever to run for election to the Academy. She's got this huge public following, and every artist in the country is riveted by her candidacy. And she comes within 2 votes of winning, and there is this enormous feeling that, yes, the world is changing, right? Everyone thinks that she's going to be a lock for election the next time around. They look at her and they say, Elizabeth Thompson, pioneer. And I think that's what we do. Why do we do that? Because it taps into our romantic notion of progress. We want to believe in pioneers because we want to believe that the world is always getting to be a better and a more open and a more tolerant place. And more than that, we can't handle the notion of contradiction. We don't want to believe that people can simultaneously love Jews and kill them, right? We want to think that there must be one simple way to make sense of human behavior. But of course, the world doesn't progress in a linear fashion. And of course, human beings aren't consistent. They are maddeningly and horribly and murderously inconsistent. That's what Eichmann tells us, and that's what Bertolt Auerbach tells us. And that's the lesson of Julia Gillard. And in retrospect, you know, the warning signs were everywhere for Elizabeth Thompson. The reaction she got for Roll Call, if you look closely at it, is not the reaction a male painter would have gotten. Yes, people were focused on the genius of her painting, but they were also obsessed with her category. They couldn't get past the fact that this was a woman had painted a war painting, a woman who never went to war, right? How could a woman think about, manage to portray male emotions so brilliantly and devastatingly? And there comes to be this whole sense of how that maybe this is her victory is just about a victory for women and not about a victory for a great artist. Someone writes a letter to the Times with this little ditty. The controversies in the press contribute to the great success and widely advertise, I guess, the picture of Miss Thompson. Right? It's about the fact that she's young and cute, they decide, right? They're not treating her as they would a normal artist. And after the success of Roll Call, she submits another painting called Quatre Bras, which is also a brilliant painting. And it also catches the imagination of the public. And it's also considered to be something, a kind of painting that people hadn't seen before. And what happens to it? They hang it, the Royal Academy hangs it in the lecture room, in the black hole, right? They're not putting her on the line in Gallery 2 anymore, right? And why do they think they can get away with that? Because they can point to what they did to Roll Call. They can say, how can you accuse us of being biased towards women? We hung Roll Call on the line. This one just isn't as good, right? That's when she stands for election to the Academy and loses by 2 votes. But inside the Academy, this isn't considered a harbinger of some great change. On the contrary, inside the Academy, now they have convinced themselves that they've solved their PR problem, right? We've proved to the world that we're open to women, now we can slam the door shut. And that's exactly what they do. The first thing they do after she almost wins is they go and they scrutinize their constitution to find out if there's some way they can bar any other woman from running for election to the Royal Academy. And when they can't find a stipulation in the constitution to support that, what do? They just pass a law that says if any woman is elected in the future, she's gonna have only a very, very narrow range of responsibilities. She won't actually be a full member of the Academy, right? And in 1881, she paints what is probably her most famous painting. It's called Scotland Forever. And I'm sure some of you have seen this one. It's from the Crimean War, from the front. It's a whole line of men on horseback, right, charging down. It's the battle of the Charge of the Light Brigade. And it's never shown at the Royal Academy. They don't even bother to exhibit it. And she never stands for election again. And she marries an English army officer, and she changes her name to Elizabeth Butler, and she raises 5 children. And she totally subordinates her career to his. In fact, when he writes his memoirs later in life, her husband, 453 pages of memoirs, her husband does not mention once the fact that he was married to one of the most famous artists in England. Meanwhile, in her memoirs, she mentions him all the time. She was a woman of her era, and at the end, she accepts the fact that the door had opened just a little bit for her, and then it was shut. Here's what she says in her memoirs. She has a grand total of 4 lines about her near election to the Royal Academy, and she ends with, "As it turned out, in 1879, I lost my election by 2 votes. Since then, I think the door has been closed, and wisely." She gives up. And why wouldn't she give up, right? It wasn't until 1936, more than 50 years later, that the Royal Academy finally elected a woman to its board. And people then looked at that first woman and said, oh, the door must finally be opening for women. But did it really open? Do you know what percentage of art hanging on the walls of American museums was painted by women? 5%. Just enough for the people running museums to say, we're not biased against women. We hung so-and-so on the line in gallery two. So do you see why I am so pessimistic about the possibility that if Hillary Clinton won, we would get another female prime minister, a president anytime soon? In fact, if you look at the history of women as head of states around the world, what is striking is how many times countries have had one female head of state and only one female head of state, that having elected one person to be their leader, they wash their hands and say, okay, we're done. Here's the list. Israel, India, Britain, Germany, Costa Rica, Finland, Nicaragua, Latvia, Panama, Bolivia, Sri Lanka, Ecuador, Haiti, Pakistan, Poland, Turkey, New Zealand, France, and Canada. And while we're on the subject, here are the list of American cities that have had one and only one black mayor. New York, Chicago, San Francisco, Los Angeles. I'm not convinced we're going to have another black president anytime soon. Sometimes when the door is opened, it's open for everybody else. Sometimes when the door is opened, it gets shut. I realize, thank you. It's a bit of a downer, I realize. I didn't mean it to be a downer, but it is a downer. Anyway. We have time for questions, so I would love to. I think there are. Oh yes. I think you're going to wait for the. Oh, I see. No. We're going to put the microphones in the corridors, and so I think we want people to line up. Otherwise, we won't be able to hear it.
Malcolm, thank you. The whole time you were talking, I kept thinking of Barack Obama and how this phenomenon is impacting the whole Obamacare fiasco. Mm-hmm. But two questions. One, so you recognize this human, I'm not sure what we call it, reality, fallacy. How do you personally deal with it? I'm looking at this room here. I'm suspecting there's a different kind of perhaps there's a different kind of dynamic. And part of that is the reaction to the movie. I saw the movie Rant recently, mm-hmm. and what I understood from it was that the negative reaction that she experienced from her reporting was to state that we were all somewhat complicit to the extent that we have this contradiction.
It is, I think, in some form, we all, if you believe the idea of moral licensing, and I don't think it's true in all cases, obviously, but I think that selectively, all of us in one way or another engage in forms of this. In certain parts of our life, we look for justifications for not doing the right thing. And that's what moral licensing is all about. It's just that we're awfully tricky. As human beings, in coming up with psychological justifications for perpetuating unfair systems, for turning our backs on people, and Eichmann is the terrifying extreme. But I think it's very useful for all of us to say, are we in very personal and specific ways doing forms of that in our own life? That's part of what I think it means to be honest about. To be morally honest about ourselves as individuals. Right. Sure.
So these women who are either pioneering or getting shut out, you'd think that they would want to make it easier for other people or other pioneers to follow in their footsteps. But what seems to happen is they kind of join this group and then they take on the moral the morality of that group, mm-hmm. and they start following their rules, and they sometimes make it more difficult, not just in women, but these sort of single poster kids that mm-hmm. make it into whatever field. They'll make it difficult for other people to do what they're doing, or they're not as supportive and they don't pave the way. Why does that happen?
Yeah, really interesting question. Hold on, get some water. So this is, I had a conversation with a female sociologist, a very prominent sociologist, on this very topic. And she was talking about exactly what you're talking about. She was saying the interesting piece here is that sometimes the token is complicit in closing the door because it enhances their own status, right? That if you're the only one, then you're seen in a different light than if you're part of a large group. And so she gave the example of, she gave the example of her own role in sociology. She said, she was an older woman. She said, when I was starting out in sociology, it was a almost entirely all-male discipline in academia. She said, the rational thing for me to have done would have been to keep it as all-male as possible so I could be the only woman. She said, I didn't do that, and what happened? The door was open to lots of other women. Sociology became dominated by female academics, with the result that what did the kind of academic patriarchy do? They devalued the prestige of the discipline. This happens time and time again, that if you lose the battle so you're the majority, you lose the battle and the outsiders come flocking in, what do you do? Well, then you just lower it. That's what happened in teaching. It happens in all kinds of different areas. As professions become feminized, the response is just to make it, so you get paid a lot less as a teacher now when the field is feminized as you did 100 years ago when it wasn't as feminine. So there's a very interesting, and so you will find a lot of hostility to the notion of the logic of tokenism among those women who have made it, who may have sometimes, may have very complex feelings about the logic of letting others in.
Thank you. Sure. I think maybe you did too good of a job of convincing me that tokens are prevalent among first timers. So now I'm afraid, and I was hoping you could.
Because you're the first man asking a question.
Exactly. Well,
yeah. Oh yeah.
So, I don't know what this means. Maybe I'm.
You're both highly visible, and we're not. I'm not thinking about you at all as an individual.
Just a male. Exactly. No, I'm afraid. I guess I'm having trouble now understanding what makes a pioneer, as opposed to a token. Is it the individual that decides this, or is it like the environment that they're in?
Yeah. Well, such a good question. Why is Jackie Robinson a pioneer? Well, because it is quickly becomes clear that it's in the self-interest of the white guys running baseball teams to hire black ballplayers. In fact, this not only were the Negro Leagues a reservoir of extraordinary talent, but they understand that it makes no sense to turn their backs on black fans. And you see all the teams that hiring black ballplayers see their attendance figures go up. So it's good business. So in that instance, it's really easy to understand. The harder ones, the cases that I've been discussing are much more like zero-sum cases where male pilots don't have much to gain by an influx of women to the profession, nor did the artists in the 19th century have much to gain by throwing the door open to even more. They were already feeling there was too many artists for too few spaces in the academy. The idea of adding another 50% of humanity to the artist pool must have seemed overwhelming to them. So I think that's one distinction.
So
but
gay marriage will become a thing once divorce lawyers realize that they're going to make a lot of money.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. You are, no, but I think, but you're right, I've just started thinking about this, so I haven't. It's a really good question. I don't have a good answer yet. There must be much more to explain why some get in and some don't.
First of all, thank you for the talk. I think a lot of feminists in the room are really happy with the analysis that you've made of Hillary Clinton's potential presidential run. And I think a lot of us are wondering what you think of Wendy Davis, since there's already been kind of a pioneer, already been a female governor in Texas mm-hmm. a while ago. Is she still a pioneer? Could she?
Yeah.
Change culture.
Well, that's interesting. You know, first of all, we don't know. It's one thing to declare, it's quite another to win. And also, like I said, I have just started to begin to I was testing this idea out on you guys, so I don't really, I haven't worked it all out. That's why these are fun to have these Q&As so I can, but I'm wondering whether there's a kind of, is there a phenomenon where you have a kind of rolling token? That's to say, I don't want to accept all of you. So in Germany, what Germany has is they always have a small group of Jews who they hold close, who they use as the psychological justification for their anti-Semitism. And when, you know, it starts out as it's court Jews, then it's Moses Mendelssohn, then it's, somebody else, and then it's Bertolt Auerbach. I mean, so they're constantly elevating a small number to make themselves feel good about themselves. And what I would wonder is whether something like this Davis gubernatorial run, is that what it is? Or is it, in fact, the door legitimately being open for everyone? And it's the sort of thing we won't know until we see, A, whether she wins, and B, what happens after that. And also, it's really, really interesting to look at the way in which her candidacy is discussed. Is her category going to be elevated above her individual self? It is still the case with Hillary Clinton that when you read press coverage of her, so much of it is you know, the amount of, how many stories has the New York Times written about her hair? I mean, it's really ridiculous. No one writes stories about politicians' hair unless they happen to be women.
Wendy Davis's pink shoes. Will she become more than her pink shoes? That's the question.
That's the question. We'll find out.
They're awesome, but yeah. Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Thank you for your very interesting books and articles over the years. My question is a little bit off topic, but the headlines have been full of stories about how much the government, Big Brother, can look into our lives. And in Florida now, there are drones which patrol the lakes. Mm-hmm. And if you catch and don't release back in an out-of-season fish, you get a citation for $500 mm-hmm. with the photo of you not releasing the fish. So Big Brother is definitely watching. What is the tipping point that we as a nation need to have the discussion about what is our privacy zone?
Yeah.
And since privacy is the root of the Roe v. Wade decision, does that discussion open that topic back up for discussion?
Yeah. Wow. That's a big and interesting question. I don't know if I have a good answer. I do think that I'm always puzzled by privacy arguments because I feel like in some areas we are excessively concerned with our privacy. In other areas, we don't care at all, and we should. So we would have a lot more efficient and open and better functioning healthcare system if we relaxed a lot of our feelings about medical privacy. We just said, look, you know, it would be really, really useful if we could share all the data of everyone in this room, and you could simply, you know, plug in your problem, and, you know, or if you could carry all your files around, if your medical records were freely shared among, you know, that's an area where privacy actually has impinged efficiency. But in other areas, you know, I have a Gmail account. God knows what Google's doing, you know. I'm fine with it. I don't change to another provider. Even they're reading my email. I mean, there's not a guy reading my email, but there could be, I suppose. I don't know. I don't even know, right? Who knows? Maybe there is. So, you know, it's a very puzzling thing that I think your point says is correct, which is that privacy is one of those unexamined questions, under-examined questions, that we better start having a smart conversation about pretty damn soon, anytime soon. Sure.
I'd like to contrast the story you told about Julia Gillard with what's happening in our home province of Ontario, where the recent premier, who's actually not been elected but has become the premier, is a woman and is gay. Mm-hmm. And from my perception, there's been zero of the kind of negative and unfair reaction to that you've described in Australia. Mm-hmm. Can you tell me why you think that has happened?
Yeah.
And generally in Canada, the Supreme Court of Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Canada is a woman, and it seems to be a total non-issue. And
yeah.
It seems as though these people, I don't know if they're pioneers, but that the as soon as a woman became got into that position, the issue seems to have melted away, and nobody's talking about
it. Are you asking me to explain why, as a Canadian, Canada is so great?
Yes.
That's what I thought. So many reasons. I mean, I don't know. I don't know if we have enough time. But there is this. There's two things I will say. These are both flippant answers to a very serious question. I don't have a good answer, but I'll give you two. Well, they're not entirely flippant. The thing about Canadian attitudes is you always forget that no Canadian attitude is created in a vacuum. So what Canadians do, I think, unconsciously and consciously, is they look over to the South, and they take their cues from what America's doing in negatively. That is to say, if America's going to go crazy about gay marriage, Canadians, I think, in a kind of hilarious and perverse way, say, "Oh, we're fine with it." If Americans want to go crazy about, you know, a woman, blah, blah, Canadians are like, "Well, it's a way of differentiating themselves." The other interesting thing, of course, Canada is that it is a country that is character is created very strongly by patterns of in and out migration. So people who want to be kind of chill, like Canadians are, move to Canada. And if you're not a chill person and you're in Canada, what do? Well, you move to America. So if you're a Tea Party person and you live in Canada, you leave. You move to Texas. You don't. So, but there's no other, like in America, there's no escape valve for those people, right? They just stay where they are and they kind of, you know, bring the government down. But in Canada, we just ship them south. So you have this wonderful, you know, now I realize this is a form of self-criticism, because what that would lead you to believe is that the reason I, as a Canadian, live in the United States is that I felt that I was not up to the snuff. I didn't meet the standard for Canadian behavior. It's probably true. But I will say that there's another way of spinning it, which is that so great is my affection for the Canadian way of life that I was willing to leave the country in order to sustain it. In other words, I thought that I would be such a downer to the that I should just get out of there and let Canadians be their wonderful, open, tolerant self.
Hi, Malcolm. My question was asked, so I'm forming one as I go, so please excuse if it's kind of rough around the edges. But what do you think this has to do with maybe the ideas of selling out versus like keeping it real? If you know those phrases, and like, let's say a person of a black descent or I'm Latino descent gets to a position, am I now in debt to bring Latino people up with me? Mm-hmm. Or should I just, you know, thinking about the whole token versus pioneer?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, so this is a really interesting question. So this is one of the strategies that you see with tokens is that in order to, their status is so precarious that in order to maintain it, they feel compelled to adopt the values of the majority group, right? So you get the phenomenon of acting white if you're one of the first black people through the door, or women who feel compelled to be to masculinize their behavior when they take certain enter all male professions. So that's a very interesting, and that actually plays into the dynamics that I'm talking about, because it's another way in which not only are you not seen for who you are, but you can't behave, you can't be who you are. You're forced to kind of take on another role. And of course, the person playing the majority then, after forcing you to act like them, will judge you even more harshly, because you're not going to be as good at being them as they are, do you know what I mean? And also, they're also picking up on your inauthenticity and ultimately judging you for it. So it's a very, very complex, I haven't worked out all of them, but it's a very complex set of things that go on that make being one of the first really, really hard. The pilot thing, to me, is really profoundly weird, because so many of the most famous early pilots were women. One of the most famous pilots of all time is Amelia Earhart. Name me another field where we have such a strong association and memory and recognition of a woman in the beginning, and yet the field turns out to be empty of women 80 years later. It's very it's a profoundly strange phenomenon that I don't entirely understand.
Hi, thank you. I'm struck locally in New York, not Canada, but by Christine Quinn as the example mm-hmm. of our most recent politically defeated woman. Bitch was constantly a undertone, I think, in the campaign. And I'm wondering if how you feel the difference between elections are really competitions and there's a clear winner and a loser, and so the possibility of overcoming these kinds of stereotypes of coming out in election cycles seems really, really challenging to me. Mm-hmm. But versus women pioneering in an industry where you're yeah. valued on merit and you're rising through and that kind of contribution, if you could speak to that difference.
Yeah. Yeah, so this is a, you've put your finger on, like I said, this argument I gave you, I'm sort of testing out. One of the weaknesses in this, or maybe it's a strength, but probably a weakness, is you're right, we've got two very different forms of tokenism here. And it seems unreasonable to assume that the same mechanisms govern professional tokens as govern electoral tokens. For example, the electoral one is really weird because 50% of voters or more of registered voters are in fact women. So you have a very, it's not like there isn't an institutional remedy available for the token. And women are squarely somehow complicit in the way women are being treated in public office, right? Whereas that's not true in, you've got a very different problem with neurosurgery where you have a whole old boys club that is networked, that is in place, an individual woman has to kind of assault. I think you're right. There must be all kinds of really interesting differences between those two conditions. And part of me wants to believe that the electoral case should be easier to overcome than the professional case, that these issues are always going to be harder in the workplace. That being said, I still don't think we're going to get a flood of women presidents. I just don't. But it should happen sooner than majority CEOs of Fortune 500 companies being women.
Thank you for this talk and for the wisdom of your work. I have not yet read David and Goliath, and I'm excited to do so. But I imagine that in many cases, Davids have the potential to either be tokens, or to be pioneers or tokens. So are there things that you can extrapolate that would make it more likely that outsiders could become the pioneers rather than the tokens in terms of who they need to be as individuals,
yeah.
or in terms of how we need to till the terrain to make it more likely that there are preconditions for more positive futures? And we do all plan to buy your book, even if you give away some of the juicy secrets in it, in this answer.
Really good question. Are there things that that outsiders can do to maximize their chances of other strategies they can follow? It's funny, in the book, I'm much more interested in the opposite case. That is the strategies that outsiders use to force their way into, in other words, that they don't attempt to win over the majority. They make an end run around the majority. I don't know how many were here last year. So you remember that talk I gave last year, a version of that talk is a chapter in the book, and it's about the civil rights movement in Birmingham. As a classic example of a group of outsiders led by Martin Luther King, trying to enter the white dominated political world. And there, it wasn't that they sat down and convinced Bull Connor that black people were actually fine. They tricked him and they took him to the cleaners and they outsmarted him in many ways. I think I have more confidence in those kinds of strategies than I do in something that's designed to kind of, I guess I'm a little bit of a pessimist on this. I don't believe that those in positions of power willingly give up their authority. I think it has to be wrested away from them.
Hi. I was wondering if you could speak to the role of pioneers in creating entirely new categories. I'm thinking specifically of about 10 years ago where the LGBT identity was more of a singular coalesced identity, and now after same-sex marriage and the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell, it seems like the transgendered community has coalesced around a distinct identity mm-hmm. from gays and lesbians.
Oh, that's interesting. That goes to an interesting question, which is, remember when we were talking earlier about how there is a possibility that tokens can be complicit in closing the door because it preserves their status. There's another interesting thing here, which is that for good reasons, outsiders may have reservations about certain kinds of, that's the wrong word, that when you are, if you're an outsider and you're accepted in part by the majority, your identity has to change. And that's a complex process, that certain parts of your identity may have been tied up in being excluded in a positive way, right? So many, what's interesting is if you talk to, for example, older African Americans who remember segregation, even though they are 100% happy that the days of segregation are over, they will also still tell you that there were aspects of being excluded that were positive. There was a sense of community and a sense of coherence, a sense of, and I think on an unconscious level, sometimes when doors are slowly and finally opening, we understand that. We understand that we are gaining something large, but we're also sometimes losing something specific or the least familiar. It's all a very abstract and complex way of saying that these moments of transition from outside to insider status, which is going on right now in the gay community, very clearly, I think that we have reached a tipping point. I don't think we're going to go back. I think there's a whole generation rising up right now who just doesn't care about, doesn't have the same emotional reaction against gay rights that the older generation did. I think this is going away as an issue. And that's a moment of profound transition that's going to take a little while to kind of work out. How do you create a new identity in a world where there isn't as much hostility from outsiders?
I'm wondering if you can expand on a comment you made earlier about the role of the pool of qualified candidates, because mm-hmm. it seems like just in the examples you gave that it would be potentially important for ball players, right, Negro Leagues, check, airline pilots. I think they came from mostly the military and fighter pilots, so not so much. And ticking through the examples, it seems like it might be an important factor.
Yeah. No, really good question. That's what Negro Leagues, that's another thing about the Negro Leagues that's really interesting. So it wasn't like you had to set up an entire infrastructure to bring this group. They're all there, really good, playing the same game, and you just have to hire them, right? With female politicians, it's a harder problem because you don't have as large a pool of available talent that's just sitting there waiting to be plucked. You actually have to go and bring people up from. Pilots are complex because I suspect that if you had a conversation with a group of 7-year-old girls and you asked them about their feelings about being a pilot, they would have an image of being a pilot that was, they would think it was inappropriate for a girl to be a pilot on some level. Not inappropriate, maybe that's too strong a word, but it wouldn't occur to them to have that as a career goal. Even though it's crazy, there's no reason why being a pilot is about multitasking and openly communicating with your peers. It's like, that's not a male specific. But the weird one is, though, is the art one. So that makes no sense. If we went to any art school in this country, it's not like it's all men. There are plenty of women out there who are wannabe artists and are up and coming artists and have lots of talented artists. They're just not in the museums, right? So there's a case where that's a little more problematic, where I would have thought that female artists were like black ball players. That there just would have been a moment where we say, you know, but even in some of the most progressive museums in this country, where you have more than 5% female, you don't have, you've got, what you have at best is 20 or 25%, which is still, you know, that's after a concerted effort. It's still puzzling why that number is as low as it is.
Before I ask my question, as I've been standing here and hearing a lot of the questions and your responses, it brings to mind the young girls who you just said wouldn't think about being pilots, as well as the neurosurgeons. Since I'm considerably older than most people in this audience, I remember when medical schools had a token woman, and now medical schools are 50% or greater women. And so I think perhaps timing is all of life, and someday neurosurgeons will have many more women in that category than today they do. And if not now, then next generation women will think about being pilots in a much greater sense than they do today. Yesterday on NPR, they talked about a woman who wanted to be in the Air Force and how she was continuously turned down, but eventually got a position. So as somebody rightly mentioned, women in the military, Air Force, often would go into commercial flying. As they grow in number, so will they. But my question is, for anybody who has worked and spoken to their supervisor, management, and presents a problem, the response is always, don't come to me with a problem, come to me with the solution. So I ask you, you brought up serious problems, very serious problems in our society. Give us some hope for a solution.
You know, this, by the way, is the last question. I just want to make that clear. The trend line of questions is getting harder and harder, so we have to cut. Oh, look, actually, we have to cut. Do I have any solutions? Well, this is a problem. I haven't, you know, as I've explained, this is all in test mode. And so I wanted to try out this idea, and I have been, and I didn't want to end on this sour note. And so I thought long and hard about is there any silver lining here? And part of me thinks that it would be dishonest to try and end on a upbeat note if I honestly don't believe that we're gonna have another female president after Hillary for a long time. Why should I pretend that everything is rosy? You know, there is, in this country, we have a tendency sometimes to assume that problems, once we've identified a problem and taken initial steps to solve it, we sometimes walk away before the solution has actually taken effect. So lots and lots of people think that racism is no longer the factor that, you know, has essentially diminished as a sizable problem in America. I think that's absolutely nonsense. I think it's just taken more subtle and insidious forms. You can't wipe out something like that in 30 years. Similarly, with this, I mean, I hear what you're saying about, I think, will we eventually get there? Yes, we will. What distresses me is a sense it's gonna take a lot longer than it ought to take. I can accept that maybe we'll get a female president 10 years after Hillary, but I worry it's gonna be 50 years or 30 years, and that's just ridiculous. So maybe I'm being a downer because that's the only way to kind of motivate us to find ways to speed up the process.
Maybe if you continue and others continue to raise these issues,
maybe we can.
There will be.
And I promise. Response. And I promise next year, it's just going to be sweetness and light. It's going to be the happiest talk you've ever seen. Thank you.